Dr. Balzac is an adjunct professor at Lazarsky University. He is an expert of European Global Navigation Satellite System Agency. Apart from having an extensive teaching career, Dr. Balzac has also held the esteemed positions of Quality and Safety Director at Flyjet Business, Executive Airline, and Director of Operations at Accountable Manager at Central Wings Airline. Dr. Balzac will speak on space debris, legal and technological problems. Sir, we're delighted to have you on board with us today. I extend a very warm welcome to you. Kindly take over.
Thank you very much, dear professors, dear organizers. Thank you very much for, it's a pleasure to be here. I would like to also to present you my presentations. So I would like to continue our discussion, dedicated for space debris, which Professor Newman previously also mentioned. Because I am professor at the university at in legal department, but also as an engineer pilot, I am also expert of European Commission in terms of evaluation of technological evaluation for aviation and space projects. So I have access to modern current technology in terms of space. So I would like to continue discussion in terms of space debris. So as you already knew, currently we have a significant launch because of lowered cost of launches for small satellites. We have a lot of small satellites at low orbit. This is like they are like SpaceX, Amazon, and others. And there is some statistics that up to 5% of these launch satellites will be not able to properly dispose themselves and at the end of their lives. So due to malfunctions or other problems, they will be not able to use them, and they will remain on their orbits as uncontrolled objects for many years, unfortunately. So these non-functioning satellites remain in valuable orbits for many years with high risk of collision with other objects. And as you can imagine, of course, each collision can generate another collision, so we could have further pollution of the orbit. So we are coming to critical moment, which is that those uncontrolled debris problem is increasing, and we could have situation that we could block all our orbits, complete pollution. So to avoid such catastrophic, let's say, scenario, we have to think about some solution from the legal base, but also from the technological base. On this slide, you should see that some information that space industry is growing, and especially for manufacturing ultra miniature small satellites below 500 kilos, there is a huge growth right now. So we have constellations where there is hundreds of such satellites on altitudes less than 1,000 kilometers. Mainly they are dedicated for some application, dedicated for civilian and but also defense applications. So there is a huge growth. Due to such huge growth, we already had few examples of severe consequences of polluted orbits. This is also a good opportunity for future and even current business. So there is a prediction that until 2034, there will be needed almost 700 missions to remove non-functioning satellites from our orbits. So there is an expectation that this value of this business will be for amount of more than 2 billion euros. There is a growing concern in terms of amount of space objects in especially low Earth orbit. And according to Satellite Industry Association report from September 2018, during last 5 years, satellites launched increased in 147% compared to previous 5 years period. So it's huge growth. Also, United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs and Committee on Peaceful Uses of Outer Space have shown their great concern about this sustainable use of outer space. According to analysis and data provided by European Space Agency, there is a special dedicated European Space Operations Center. Space object in low Earth orbit must be maintained in safe operating scope for not to damage further development space industry. So following on the following slide, I will provide you some data that you will be able to understand the size of this matter. So you see two photos here on this slide, left on the left side and on the right side. It shows the simulation on the future low Earth orbit environment in case no additional measures are taken. This is the left photo. So we will continue space business as usual scenario. And on the right side, compared to measures that we will be take and responsive and the responsible legal system and technology to remove those debris. So you see the difference in both, let's say, scenario. In terms of technology, because I, as I mentioned you, I have fresh access to when I'm evaluating projects from the companies, mainly European, of course, companies that they are applying for grants from European Union. So there is a continuously need to active debris removal missions in the future. And we could have, of course, there is a several technology that we can use. I would like to mention only three, the most, let's say, popular, that the most, let's say, popular within aviation space company here in Europe. So first one is tradition multi-axis gripper. This technology is quite complex because there is several electrical motors and sensors needed, must grip the satellites cramped, and one gripper cannot be used for all, of course, satellites classes. The second technology is dedicated, is based on Harpoon. This is high risk of generation of debris. When penetrating target. Of course, during this penetration, there is a high risk of creating unintended effects. We can hit other place, other space within our batteries, for example, or some electrical fuel tanks, which can cause even some bigger explosion. And the third one, Mr. Professor Newman also presented this technology on his slide. This is net technology. This advantage is that this net technology is not reversible, only loose connection between target and service spacecraft and the risk of collision between them. Coming back to legal base, pursuant to Article 6 of Treaty of Principle of Active Activities of States in Exploration and Use of Outer Space, including Moon and other celestial bodies, as Professor Newman said, states are responsible for their activities in outer space, regardless of whether it is carried by governmental or non-governmental institutions. persons as well for ensuring that those activities comply with provisions of this agreement. This provision was further developed also, as you know, in convention from 1972. And according to Article 2 of this convention, launching states are under absolute obligation to pay compensation for any damage that their launched space object has caused off the surface of the Earth or to an aircraft in flight. But on the other hand, for damage caused elsewhere, the issuing state is liable only where the damage is attributable to its fault or the fault of person for whom is responsible. So we have to prove this fault. Until actually 2020, last year, let's say, Article 2 from this convention from 1972 had practical application into events. First one was from 1978 when former Soviet Union nuclear-powered observation satellite sprayed radioactive debris over large uninhabited area on northwest Canada, and Canada demanded $6 million US dollars in damage from former Soviet Union. Actually, they finalized this in diplomatic way, and they agreed to pay Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, agreed to pay $3 million. The second event took place a year later in 1979. The remains of U.S. space station Skylab were scattered over Western Australia and the Southern Indian Ocean without causing any damage. NASA announced a claim under this convention, but not received any. In terms of Article 3, this convention relating to damage elsewhere, until also last year, there was no practical application. I would say that there is there was one collision in space, but states parties of this convention did not decide to apply its this procedure. The largest collision occurred in February 2009. The activated Russian military telecommunication satellite and operational U.S. telecommunication satellite Iridium collide at altitude almost 800 kilometers above northern Siberia. But because of the speed over 12 kilometers per second, there was full, let's say, destroyed. This equipment was destroyed. Due to similar dangers and international obligations, states require currently private entities to obtain their license for space activities. So it's similar like in aviation for airlines. Also, the other requirement is for insurance to cover possible state liability, as also Mr. Professor Newman said. And in terms of insurance, actually, my friend who is working in UK in insurance company, he mentioned me that they have some offer for insurance for rocket only for six seconds. So they cover only their risk for 6 seconds of taking off the rocket. So, but in terms of insurance, we have few options. The most popular is in the event of material losses, financial losses, property damage, etc. This policies may cover the space object during production, so from the start, before launch, after launch, and also while in the orbit. Second type of insurance is against financial losses, usually covers loss of profits or additional costs that may arise if space objects will suffer material damage. This requirement is already implemented in few countries. Of course, the good example is United States and Great Britain. It should be also noted that the European Union, which is, let's say, owning about, let's say, 19-20% of all active satellites, there was in 2014, the European Parliament issued decision establishing framework for support space surveillance and tracking. The aim of this system is to plan and implement risk reduction in terms of collision with space debris. So observation of uncontrolled entry of spacecraft or space debris into Earth atmosphere will allow more effectively early warning, thus will reduction possible threat to security of European, in our case, citizens, and reduction possible damage to ground infrastructure. Summarizing, the space, the subject of we are calling space debris relates to operative objects remaining in space, such as broken satellites, as I mentioned. According to data from European Space Agency from 2017, there is almost 20,000 objects classified as space debris orbit, as space debris, and they are orbited around our planet. So there is this amount is more amount of those objects. There is more than satellites. Active satellites, working satellites in operations. One of the most important institutions coordinating activities related to space debris is Interagency Space Debris Coordination Committee, which in 2018 brought together 13 space agencies. In September 2017, this committee issued official statement regarding large satellite constellation in low Earth orbit. And this committee draw attention to number of issues that should be taken into account by satellite producers and operators. So I am going to mention few of them. So first one, in order to minimize potential risk of collision, this committee recommends that consideration be given to appropriate distance between constellation object as well between different constellations. The second, also committee recommends designing satellites in such a way as to increase probability of their removal in the event of failure. So they should have some mechanism, automatic mechanism to remove themselves from orbit in case of termination, for example, mission or some failure. And there is also recommendation that each satellite should be working no more than 25 years, and then this satellite should be removed from the orbit. Third recommendation is that satellites should be designed in such a way to minimize likelihood of explosion. Also, to avoid potential collision, so they should have some kind of mechanism, maneuvering mechanism, to avoid collision on the orbit. And fourth, let's say main recommendation is to increase ability to track and monitor objects in the space. And as I mentioned already, within the European Union, we have such operation center that is monitoring. Of course, let's say probability it's huge, but not 100% as usual. So far, So far, there is no international treaty comprehensively regulating the obligation of space users to avoid production of space debris or to dispose of space debris that already they are generated. According to European Space Agency, government space agency have declared for time being, and this is only declaration, legally not binding, that they will make efforts to clear the most important orbits from the space debris. The problem is, of course, that collecting space debris is mainly due to the fact that that is several times more expensive. So the process of collecting technology is more expensive than sending rockets to orbit. But of course, this is not changing the fact that the countries that sending a given object into space as a rule should be real responsible for its further activity. And regulation of the subject can be also found in this convention from 1972, which actually Poland is also a party. But provisions of this convention are intended to protect aggrieved persons. However, due to date of this convention, its provisions are not updated to contemporary realities. And of course, certain archaic nature of this convention in the light of its provision is also problematic to prove damage. As I mentioned, the proof of damage is to prove that the damage was unadoptedly caused by space debris belonging to appropriate owner, appropriate entity. So this is the main problem. And final slide. As we know, space is for everyone. However, legal rules that apply there must necessarily be updated, extended, and clarified. It's the well understood interest of all countries that there are ambitious regulations and actions programs in place to tackle the problems related to the use of space. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the wonderful speech, sir.